Welcome again to This Cultural Moment, a podcast about following Jesus in the post-Christian world. I'm John Mark Comer, here with my dear friend Mark Sayers, and we actually have a third guest in the studio today, Pete Hughes, all the way from London, England. Pete is the pastor of KXC, or King's Cross Church, one of the best churches I know, in one of the most difficult cities in all of the Western world to follow Jesus, much less to do church. And Pete is here, and we want to mix it up a little bit and host a multi-part conversation with Pete over the next few episodes. And basically, he's here because at the end of season one, a number of you via email or social media were asking, okay, this is great, but how do we translate all of this idea, theory, backstory, fun factoid stuff, Russian spies, into day-to-day life on the ground in our church, in our community, in our apprenticeship to Jesus, in our post-Christian world and or city? And so we brought in Pete, who is in town with us here at Bridgetown, and said, let's just have a conversation around the table about the future of the church in a city like a London, England.
Your destiny's hidden in your history. There's something about what God wants to do in the future that you need to look back to find out what that is. This is a place where empires are colliding, but we know that there's one empire that will outlast all others. It's called the Kingdom of God.
So we're in this post-Christian secular moment. It feels like the world's falling apart. Feels like there's no hope for Western civilization, much less for the church in it. Mark, just recap that moment for us.
There's a sense that we've reached a stage of secularism where no longer is it a comfortable secularism. It's a secularism which doesn't just undermine faith, but undermines everything. So we've seen this sort of falling of all these cultural monoliths, these cultural giants, from Hollywood to sports to politics. We're just seeing things revealed, and this is Christ's judgment coming against the powers.
Even in the church.
Even in the church. We're seeing, I guess, elements of the church, which is held on to earthly power versus the way of Jesus, falling over. So that judgment of Jesus that comes against anything that's not of him, we're seeing in our time. And it's a frightening time, but I actually think we need to reframe it as the kind of time that God used to start things anew. In Australia, the Australian Aboriginals would burn off parts of the bush in this controlled burning. And they did that so that new growth could come up. And I think God does that, that we're seeing one of those moments where there's a fire going through, but it's to start something new. So when it's tempting to feel fear, I actually think this is a time when we need to turn to faith and see the possibilities that God has for us.
Yeah, so I mean, the word that followers of Jesus have used for a very long time around that is revival. Mm. And I think we have mixed feelings about that word. I mean, I hear it and just kind of smacks of, I don't know, church nostalgia or whatever. Mm. Yet that is the pattern of the move of the Spirit down through church history. And revival is not about a technique, right? As much as it is about a hunger and a thirst for more of the Spirit of God.
And even revival can turn into a thing of human striving. Stuart Piggin, who is an Australian...
Stuart Piggin?
Piggin.
Let's say thank you right now that my last name's not Piggin.
He's Piggin out. No, it's a terrible joke, but a great historian. And he talks about the fact that there was different times of revival, that it's a natural part of church history, that God works through these renewals. It's not like secularism is one moment and then it's a slow drop off. But he talks about the fact that particularly some of the later revivals got mixed up with hype, got mixed up with control, particularly in some parts of the United States where there was this sense where people confronted the post-Christianness of early America with this temptation to take a move of God, but then channel it through human means. So it's understandable that some people feel tired of that revival where it's like a couple who have the same date night every week and it's just this thing they're going through rote and it means nothing because they secretly don't like each other anymore. So that doesn't mean you throw out the date night, because a date night can be this intimate, incredible, first love moment. So that's what I think, is a possibility at this time. It's this opportunity where what if God wants to do something new in this time, even if we don't really believe it? Are we willing to really hope that God will move at this time?
And Martin Lloyd-Jones said something about that, right? About revival?
Yes. He wrote it's a book that was a series of lectures he did in 1959 preaching to the church in Britain. And he saw, I think, very early how much Britain and, again, the rest of the Western world would be shaped by secularism. He said that in the past, when you looked at revivals, in a sense, all that needed to happen was, say, for Charles Wesley to awaken people. They knew their Bible. They knew God. They just had fallen into sin or, you know, fallen into out-of-church-going religious practice. But he said that what Britain was facing in 1959, he saw it, was the kind of revival which, using the text from Mark, where Jesus says about a particular spirit that was possessing a boy, he said, this kind of spirit doesn't come out without prayer and fasting. And so Lloyd-Jones says that, and it's incredibly prophetic. He said, it's not going to be technique. It's not going to be doing things in a more professional manner. It's not going to be human striving. This renewal, this revival, this refreshment will come through our understanding our weakness, through getting on our knees, to crying out for the Holy Spirit. So I think this sort of disillusionment that some people may feel about, man, we've been doing all this stuff for ages. Like, we've been doing missional church for years, or we've been trying to engage with the business world for years, and we have these little wins, but we're yearning for something more. It's time not to get disillusioned at faith. It's time to get disillusioned at the level of our faiths.
Got it. Speaking of revival and speaking of England, we have in the studio, in the world headquarters of this cultural moment, also known as a dingy closet in the basement of First Baptist Church with no window, and it's hot and it's stuffy and it's ugly. But at the world headquarters, we have here Pete Hughes, all the way from London, England. And Pete is one of the best pastors I know, of one of the best churches I've ever been to. And he's a dear friend. We've been friends, I don't know how long, Pete, six years, something like that. And fun fact, our churches actually started on the same Sunday. And we didn't know each other at the time. We met a year or two later and hit it off. And our churches have been in similar contexts on similar journeys. And there's been, I think, a lot of mutual learning, but I feel far more debt to you than anything else, or gratitude toward you and KXC. And we have Pete here because, you know, at the end of season one, we got a lot of people saying, okay, great, where do we go from here? How do we do church? How do we do apprenticeship to Jesus in this kind of a cultural moment? And, you know, we just want to begin by saying it's not a technique. You lead one of the best churches I know, Pete. It's cool, it's smart, it's thoughtful, it's holistic, all of that. But at the end of the day, what makes you, you, and KXC, KXC, isn't a technique. It's not some new vibe or branding or website or any of that. It's something else. So we just want to have a set of conversations with Pete as a practitioner, really a case study of a church in one of the most difficult cities in the Western world to do church in, that is thriving right in the corrosive soil of a secular kind of world gone mad. So, Pete, just to start off, like, maybe tell us a little bit about your story, and not just your story in KXC, but even the story of London and East London, where you're at, King's Cross.
Yeah, so we planted 2010, and King's Cross historically, if you ask, you know, British people about King's Cross, they'll say, oh, it's a bit of a dive, which means historically red light district, an area of deprivation, serious poverty, a major transport hub. And yet behind this kind of transport hub, this massive station, King's Cross St. Pancras, was like a wasteland. And then the vision to redevelop this wasteland kicked in sort of like mid-2000s. And now over the last decade, been like crazy level of influx of wealth, the business community, a student population.
And it's so, kind of the cool part of town,
exactly,
right? Creatives,
and the
20-somethings.
Likes of Google have moved in, Facebook moved in, Guardian, one of our big papers, present there. So you've got this kind of new community that's established, but then you've got, it's surrounded by pockets of extreme deprivation. So you've got these worlds colliding, which is just a fascinating environment. So we planted back in 2010, just when the redevelopment was gathering momentum, with a vision to be part of the unfolding story of King's Cross. Something new was happening, and what if we planted a church community right in the heart of that, living for the kingdom of God, and, you know, see what happens.
But there's even history farther back than that, right? So, I mean, you're in this interesting neighborhood, kind of classic 20-somethings, making a ton of money working for Google or whatever as a designer, with immigrants from Ethiopia or whatever, or classic, like, you know, multi-generational poverty from London. But there's a deeper history even behind that. Do you feel like you bump up against that? Talk to us about that.
So a couple of conversations I had, one was with Mark a year or so ago, and you'd been on this journey of like looking into the history of Melbourne and trying to figure out what's the spiritual story that maybe we're coming up against. And then I was in a conversation with Alan Scott, and he just had this phrase that...
And Alan Scott, if you don't know him, he's a vineyard leader from Ireland, just moved to California, an incredible kind of leader.
Yeah, brilliant thinker on cultural engagement. And he basically said to me, you know, and I think he was prophesying over the church at KXC, but speaking more generally as well, that your destiny is hidden in your history. Mm. There's something about what God wants to do in the future that you need to look back to find out what that is in terms of the spiritual inheritance of the place. And so we got fascinated with, well, you know, we're living in this story of God, but we want that story to impact the story of King's Cross. So let's do some homework. What is the story of King's Cross? And just a couple of edited highlights. So you go right back to AD 60, where there was this big battle. Before it was called King's Cross, it took on the name King's Cross like 1800s. Way before that, it was called Battle Bridge. And the name came from AD 60. There's a battle between the Celtic tribe led by Queen Boudicca and the Romans that were coming in. And there was this massive kind of clash of empires. A battle took place over the River Fleet, and then it took the name Battle Bridge. And just looking into that story, because we'd been coming up against it, it feels like this is a place where empires are colliding. There's like this conquest, there's this kind of like battle that we're caught up in, and then realize, wow, like quite literally this place was formed as a settlement where these two empires had collided. And again, we began to take courage from that, of actually this is a place where empires are colliding, but we know that there's one empire that will outlast all others. It's called the Kingdom of God. So that kind of like faith level started to rise. And then we kind of read into the story way after that, still called Battle Bridge. But the Romans came in carrying the relics of St. Pancras to Britain. They settled in Essex and then realised they didn't want to be in Essex for obvious reasons. I'm obviously joking.
For those of you
I
from
love
England,
Essex.
You all just got that joke.
Yeah.
The rest of us are like, what?
So then moved from Essex into London and settled at Battle Bridge. And they kind of thought, well, this is going to be our base, mission base, so that we can take the gospel from here to the four corners of Britain and convert Britain to Christianity. And as we read that story, it was like, wow, this is in our history. That this, you know,
it's the name of the train station.
Exactly.
I mean, it's
King's
still,
Cross. There you go.
Yes.
And before, you know, King's Cross was sending out goods across the country, long before that, it was sending out good news. Missionaries were being sent all over the place, preaching the gospel.
And to this day, it's like the hub, the rail hub,
yeah,
right?
The
for
rail
London,
hub for all
over
Europe,
England.
All of Europe, all of England.
So if you come into London, this happens a lot, like, and you then have to head up to Scotland or Birmingham or whatever,
yeah,
you come to King's Cross, St. Pancras Station, two blocks from your church, and you travel from there.
Yeah, so it was like, well, this is our history. Like, you know, the missionaries bring Christianity to Britain, settling in King's Cross, and one of the oldest sites of worship is at Old St. Pancras, right in the heart of the area, sending out the good news of Jesus. And we're like, well, this is in our history. We want this to be part of our destiny. We want King's Cross and KXC as a church to be sending out missionaries, to be sending out church plants. And as we began to engage in the history and bring that into a conversation with the story of God, I think we realized, wow, there is a battle on our hands. We're caught up in a battle. And what you said about fear and faith is fascinating. I think the more we engaged in that, almost there was a level of intimidation we came up against. And it was a moment of like, do we back down in this moment? Like, are we biting off more than we can chew? And yet at the same time, turning to God in this moment of weakness and faith levels beginning to rise. And I think we've been in a fascinating moment as a church, a kind of threshold moment where we've realized like we don't have what it takes. However good our thinking is and might be on cultural engagement, that won't be enough. However great our leadership development programs are, spiritual formation programs are, all of that stuff's super important, but it won't be enough. What we need to do is get on our knees and ask God to move in power to see something remarkable take place that's way beyond what we could ever do. But coming to God in weakness and saying, look, we truly believe that your power is made perfect in weakness, so come and do something remarkable. And that's the moment we feel like we're in as a church.
But, I mean, the interesting thing there is, Pete, you're honestly, and this is not flattery, one of the best leaders I've ever met in my life. You're smart, you're educated, you're bold, you're courageous, you have this incredible team. Your church is cool, it's thoughtful, but yet you've come to the end of your rope in this kind of a cultural moment just to realize the future isn't how do we make this cooler, how do we make this smarter, how do we make this more strategic. The future is humility, weakness, prayer.
Absolutely. And I felt even personally in this, like really vulnerable, feeling really exposed. And Matthew 5 in the Message translation, beautiful translation, it says, you're blessed when you're at the end of your rope with less of you. There is more of God and his rule. Yeah. And I've come up against these moments in the last few months where I'm like, I'm at the end of myself. Like, I've got nothing left. There's kind of some fatigue probably in the mix. There's some discouragement. I feel this kind of intimidation of the enemy saying, look, back down. Like, this is going to be costly. Do you really want this? And at the end of myself, basically coming to the point of God, like, without you, I'm stuffed. Mm. So we're asking that you'd come and do something remarkable. We come to you in humility, as you said, in weakness. We feel foolish right now, but we're trusting that you take the foolish things to shame the wise, the weak to shame the strong. So count us in. So it feels like a moment of faith levels rising. But is there some fear in the mix? Absolutely there is. And I think this longing for revival, it's stirring in the UK. And this idea that prayer and fasting is at the heart of that. Because, like, humanly speaking, you look at the state of the church in the UK and worldwide, people know this, right? That the church has been hemorrhaging and millennials are leaving. And, you know, the average age is getting older and older. You know, does the church have a future in the UK? And yet, at the same time as that vulnerability within the wider church in Britain, there's a movement of prayer kicking off. There's this initiative led by the Archbishop and the Pope's on board. So, like, Anglicans across the world and Catholics coming together. It's called Thy Kingdom Come. And in the build-up to Pentecost, the churches are gathering in cathedrals and wherever they can to get on their knees and say, God, we want to see a revival in this land. We're coming together to contend for the next great awakening. And it feels really exciting. And it's not from this place of strength of, like, we can do this.
Right.
It's from a place of, like, we can't do this. You know, Lord, we need you. Come and do something remarkable in our time.
Mm. There's this sense, too, that I sense so much that guts that it takes to do that, a guts that doesn't come from yourself. Because in a sense, we've come out of this moment where almost like people have, you know, in the 80s and 90s looking at megachurch and, wow, that's going to make it happen. And then there was this pushback. It was like, okay, we'll go from the massive and then we'll go to the really small. So instead of the big mall, we're going to go to like the tiny little neighborhood store and we're just going to like be in this neighborhood. And I so admire people who do that. I tried to do that for a long time. But then I just felt God saying, but is your vision too small? Is your vision too small? And, you know, for me too, you mentioned about Melbourne, looking at my city going, hang on, the story that I told about my city, that it's always been a secular place. And then you read about these revivals that happen at different times, which came purely through prayer. So I remember standing up and starting to just talk about, what if God wants to do something? And almost like this, are you kidding me? I could hear the dialogue of my cynical 21st century person in the back of my head going, really? These people have tried this, or this
happened.
Because
that cynic is just so lodged in there.
Man.
So anytime you try to grow faith for a move of God in a city like a Portland or a Melbourne or London, part of you is just laughing at yourself.
Yeah, totally. And because the Christian culture is so sped up, we've now seen multiple movements. We've seen, you know, emerging church. We've seen missional church. We've seen new reformed churches. We've seen this ministry engaging with business in this way or this sector. And we've seen all of this stuff in a very quick time. And so this sense to go, hang on, what if it's yes, none of that's bad, but what if it's actually purely turning to God and I have nothing left? It's coming to revival, but as you said, not out of a sense of personal power.
Man, I love that. On that note, let's hit the pause button. We'll be back next week in our next episode with more conversation with the one and only Pete Hughes around the future of revival in the church in the West. Thanks so much for listening. Do us a favor, spread the word if this was helpful to you at all. Please post something on social media, write a review online, whatever is your style. Have a great week, and we'll catch you back soon.